Hello friends, welcome to a session of respiratory diseases. We have discussed what is asthma. We will see what is COPD, that is chronic obstructive airway disease or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. The basic difference of asthma and COPD is again reversibility. It is defined as airflow limitation that is not fully reversible. And COPD includes two major diseases, that is chronic bronchitis, which is a clinical disease, and second is emphysema, which is an anatomical condition. And the chronic airflow obstruction is the basic and most part of COPD, that every patient should have the component of airflow obstruction. It is important when a patient of chronic bronchitis comes to you, and if that patient is not having chronic airflow obstruction, you cannot keep that patient as a COPD, or you cannot label that patient as a COPD. This definition of emphysema, as I told you, it's an anatomical condition which defines as a destruction and enlargement of the lung alveoli. And chronic bronchitis is a clinical condition which is defined as a chronic cough with sputum production. And you must aware that what is the chronic cough. How will you define chronic cough? What is the duration when you will label cough as a chronic? So duration is more than 6 weeks. Patient who having cough more than 6 weeks, you can label that cough as a chronic cough. So chronic cough, cough more than 6 weeks and production of sputum. Yes, it is a chronic bronchitis. And for putting that chronic bronchitis in COPD, there should be a part of airflow obstruction. Coming to a risk factor, the risk factor of COPD, the most important first three factors are cigarette smoking is the most important and proven factor of COPD, which will lead to a COPD. It's a proven risk factor. Other factors like occupational or genetic predispositions are also there. And respiratory infections also play an important part as an acute exacerbation of COPD. Regarding occupational exposure, workers who are working in a factory, they are at a risk of developing COPD. So they should undergo a regular pulmonary checkup in the form of regular spirometry or chest x-ray. Coming to genetic predisposition, the important genetic predisposition is alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, which is associated with COPD as well as with liver dysfunction. So this patient may develop COPD or even liver failure or cirrhosis. Coming to a slide again, regarding airway responsiveness and COPD, there are many hypotheses indicating relationship between COPD and asthma. There are two famous hypotheses. First one is a Dutch hypothesis and second one is London hypothesis. According to Dutch hypothesis, the COPD and asthma are a part of same disease, but the presentation is different. And according to London hypothesis, COPD and asthma are completely different disease and they cannot be related to each other. Coming to a pathophysiology, chronic exposure to cigarette smoking will lead to inflammatory changes in airway. It will lead to recruitment of inflammatory cells which will release elastolytic proteinases, and it will lead to structural cell death, ineffective repair of elastin, and pulmonary emphysema. So the initiating part of pathophysiology in COPD is cigarette smoking, which start inflammation, which will release elastinase and proteinase. This enzyme will destruct tissues around the alveoli, and because of ineffective repair, there will be a formation of pulmonary emphysema. This pulmonary emphysema will lead to airflow obstruction and hyperinflation. Hyperinflation is because of air trapping in the lung. Because of chronic obstruction, because of airway obstruction, there is a little space for air to get out of lung. So there is an air trapping and it will lead to hyperinflation. And in exam point of view, you should note that in COPD patient, there is a persistent reduction in forced expiratory flow rates. Coming to clinical presentation, clinical presentation, patient may start with cough, sputum production, exertional dyspnea, signs of active smoking. Signs of active smoking means patient may be having odor of smoke, patient may be having staining of cigarette on nails and even on lips. So you should immediately note that patient is having habit of smoking, even though patient may be denying the history of smoking. So actively you should look for signs of smoking. There is expiratory wheezing, tripod position, and signs of hyperinflation. Tripod position means the patient of COPD will lie on their upper limb. They will lean forward to get a help from their accessory muscles. They will get that relief by leaning forward. It is typically labeled as a tripod position. And there will be a signs of hyperinflation. Because of hyperinflation or air trapping, there will be the dullness of liver may vanish. Coming to a signs of hyperinflation, when you percuss lung, you may get obliteration of liver dullness or obliteration of your heart dullness or cardiac dullness. There will be an increasing anterior posterior diameter. There may be a signs of right heart failure. You must be knowing what are the signs of right heart failure. The signs of right heart failure will start from JVP. You will see an engorged vein in the neck. You will see palpation of the liver. You may see edema on feet. So right-sided heart failure is a sign of severe COPD. And coming to an important part, that is clubbing. It is very common to see clubbing in smokers. And when you see clubbing in smoker, your diagnosis, it should not be a COPD. He may be a patient of COPD, but you should not blame clubbing to COPD. So a clubbing may indicate underlying severe disease like lung cancer, because lung cancer also has a common risk factor of smoking. So this is an important point regarding your clinical practice as well as your exam. Regarding pink puffers and blue bloaters, this pink puffer and blue bloaters are very famous old term used previously, but they are not so helpful in today's era. This pink puffer, they used to say that pink puffer patient has a predominant emphysema and blue bloater has a predominant chronic bronchitis. But it's not so easy to differentiate these two entities clinically. So these terms you may be asked in your exam, but as per my knowledge, I will say they are not so significant in today's era. Coming to a diagnosis of COPD, yes, COPD is a clinical diagnosis. There should be a history of smoking. You may demonstrate airway obstruction by using a spirometry or pulmonary function test. An important pulmonary function test is FEV1 or FVC or ratio of FEV1 to FVC. Coming to a slide again, there will be evidence of airflow obstruction. There will be a reduction in FEV1. There will be increase in TLC, FRC and RV. All these capacities will be increased and the blame goes to hyperinflation of lung. And as there is a decrease in FEV1 and increase in FVC, the ratio of FEV1 and FVC will naturally go down. Coming to a goal criteria of COPD severity, I will explain that severity or goal criteria on board. There are 5 stages of severity ranging from 0, 1st, 2, 3 and 4. 0, 1st, 2nd, 3rd and 4. And we can classify this severity depending on FEV1 ratio to FVC, and second test is FEV1. In stage 0, both the finding will be normal. So it will be more than 70%. It will be again more than 80%. In stage 1st, this ratio will be less than 70%, but the FEV1 will remain more than 80%. In stage 2, this again ratio will remain less than 70%. The less than 70% will apply to all stages. So in second stage, this FEV1 will be less than 80 but more than 50. For stage 3, less than 50 and more than 30. And in last stage, that is stage 4, it will be less than 30. Okay, so these are the stages of COPD severity. And in stage 4, that patient will be having signs of right-sided failure. When patient is having FEV1 of between 50 to 70 plus signs of right-sided heart failure, that patient, you can again put it as a stage 4 rather than keeping that patient in stage 3. So this is important point in view of your exam. In exam, they may ask you that patient's FEV1 is between 50 to 30 plus signs of right-sided failure. Then where you keep that patient into, in which severity, your answer should not be in stage 3. But because of presence of signs of right heart failure, you should keep this patient in stage 4. Coming to slide again, other test you can do as a coming to arterial blood gases. there will be an exertional hypoxia. Second test is 6-minute test. Third is a radiographic and a measurement of alpha 1 antitrypsin level. Regarding 6-minute test, I want to elaborate something regarding 6-minute test. This 6-minute test is recently evaluated for monitoring of COPD patient. In 6-minute test, ask the patient to walk for 6 minutes in controlled environment and measure saturation, that is SpO2. Even you can use finger pulse ox at the start of test and at the end of test and see the difference. If you find there is exertional hypoxia, you can say patient is having COPD, and this 6-minute test is not helpful only for diagnosis, but it is also helpful for monitoring of COPD patient. The treatment we are giving is right or wrong, whether the patient is responding to treatment or not. So 6-minute test has a diagnostic as well as monitoring benefit. Coming to a measurement of serum alpha-1 antitrypsin level, if there is severe deficiency of alpha-1 antitrypsin, then you should ask pathologist to do protease inhibitor test or determination of protease inhibitor, because that is the definitive test for determining alpha-1 antitrypsin level. Regarding treatment, even if COPD and asthma are linked to each other, the treatment is not same. Some students may have an impression that treatment of COPD and asthma is the same. They write same answer for asthma as well as COPD, but that is not true. The treatment of COPD is completely different. The only definitive treatment of COPD, there are three definitive treatment which will have an effect on natural history, and remaining treatment will be only of symptomatic relief. So the first three major treatment is, first one is ask the patient to stop smoking. Smoking has a definitive risk factor for COPD. Once patient stop smoking cigarettes, there is a chance that pulmonary function may improve after 5 or 10 years. Second thing is oxygen therapy. Oxygen therapy, as soon as you find there is a evidence of hypoxemia at rest, there should be a hypoxemia at rest to start oxygen therapy. And the indication of oxygen therapy for patients who are having exertional hypoxia, they are not so clear. But there is a clear evidence that you should start oxygen therapy for patients who are having desaturation or less than 90% oxygen saturation at rest. And third most important treatment is lung volume reduction surgery in selected patient with emphysema. Coming to symptomatic therapy, we have an option of bronchodilator in a form of beta-2 agonist, inhaled anticholinergics, and also inhaled glucocorticoids. Regarding glucocorticoids, there is very important role of inhaled glucocorticoids. But in COPD, there is no definitive role of glucocorticoid. So you should not use inhaled steroid for COPD. Instead, you should prescribe oxygen therapy. So, but for decreasing exacerbation of COPD, you can try inhaled glucocorticoids, because there are evidence which show that there is a decrease exacerbation of COPD by giving inhaled glucocorticoid. So that frequency should be more than 2 or 3 per year. When patient is having exacerbation of COPD more than 2 or 3 times in a year, you can prescribe inhaled corticosteroid in view of preventing exacerbation. But there is no role of using oral corticosteroid chronically. Coming to theophylline, again, you can use along with beta-2 agonist or anticholinergic. They show some modest improvement. Coming to N-acetylcysteine, even though it's a proven mucolytic or antioxidant property, it has failed to show any significant benefit on COPD outcome. Next part is a role of augmentation therapy, that is IV alpha-1 antitrypsin therapy. This therapy is indicated in severe deficiency of alpha-1 antitrypsin patient, along with there should be an abnormal pulmonary function test, or at least there should be an abnormal X-ray or CT scan. If patient is having only severe deficiency without any abnormal finding on pulmonary function test, so you should not give that augmentation therapy. For augmentation therapy, there should be a severe deficiency along with abnormal PFT. For preventing COPD, patient should receive influenza vaccine annually and polyvalent pneumococcal vaccine. Coming to a definitive therapy, I will say a lung transplantation is the only definitive therapy for COPD. But as the issue of availability of lung transplant or lung donor, you cannot advise lung transplant for every patient of COPD. So it's a limitation for lung transplantation. Coming to emergencies in COPD, this exacerbation of COPD is not so uncommon, and exacerbation is usually because of viral and bacterial infection. And as I told you, you can use inhaled glucocorticoids for preventing those exacerbation. While treating, you can combine beta 2 agonist, anticholinergic, theophylline along with antibiotic. And here again you can give glucocorticoid as an intravenous or oral steroid to hasten recovery from exacerbation of COPD. If patient is in respiratory failure, you can advise non-invasive or in some cases invasive ventilation. So it was a discussion regarding COPD. Thank you.